Wellspring Ministries presents Streams in the Desert, hosted by Pastors George and Sharon Stover. This dynamic Las Vegas couple bring the life-changing Word of God alive through the anointed prophetic ministry. Their teaching causes mountain-moving faith to bring the victory of God's love to bear on the everyday issues of life. Join George and Sharon now as they share with you the secrets and the joys of a fulfilling and abundant Spirit-filled and Spirit-led life.
And we're very honored, very privileged to have this wonderful man of God to be with us today. And so give John Routon, Pastor John Routon, a hand as he comes. Hallelujah. And, it's your house, sir.
Praise the Lord. Okay. All right. Well, it's a joy and honor to be with all of you here today at Wellspring Church of All Nations. And thank you, Pastor George, for the kind invitation. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to share with you. Praise the Lord. How many of you are glad you're here today? Can I see your hand? How many would rather be here than the best hospital in Nevada? Can I see your hand? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Please sit down. Praise the Lord. I want to share with you from the Word of God today, and let's just believe God today that He'll give us what we need. Amen. You know that God knows you by name. He knows where you're headed. He knows your tomorrow better than you can remember your yesterday. And He knows how to get you there. Praise the Lord. And so whenever I preach, I'm always aware that God has a purpose for our assembling together. And it's not just to take up space and kill time. We're not just here because our favorite program doesn't come on TV till the evening time. God's got something He wants to impart to us. Amen. So I don't want you to just sit back like you're waiting for the bus. I want you to lean forward. I want you to have a sense of expectation in your heart today that God can give you something. Don't worry about me. Hallelujah. Just worry about yourself. Hallelujah. And you need to believe God that He'll give you a word from heaven. One word from God can change your life forever. Hallelujah. And see, this message that I'm preaching right now is not just for right now. It's also for tomorrow. So you may be asleep today and you won't be ready for tomorrow. So listen carefully to what God has to say to you. Amen. And you need to believe God today that He'll even speak to me, speak through me, work through me to get to you for whatever you need in your life right now. I don't know you and I don't know what you need, but God knows you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Can I get an amen, please? It's real quiet in this Presbyterian church. Hallelujah. I lift up both hands to heaven. We're going to pray right now. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We thank you for these precious people. We pray today that you would give us and feed us and nourish us in the words of faith. I believe that you'll open the hearts of these people the way you opened the heart of Lydia to receive and to respond the things which were spoken by Paul. I pray that he that speaks today may speak as the very oracles of God, and may he that minister today do so with the ability that you furnish. Thank you, Holy Ghost, for fresh oil from heaven. I believe, Father God, today that you will be glorified in this place and magnified in all that we say and do, and may the words of our mouths and meditation of our heart be acceptable in your sight, O God. We thank you for the blood of Jesus, and we plead the blood right now over these people. We thank you for cleansing. We thank you for mercy today. We thank you for your presence, and we come boldly to the throne of grace today. We thank you, and we give you praise in the name of Jesus. And someone shout, amen.
Amen.
I want you to turn with me this morning to the book of Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14, and I'm going to read a passage of Scripture to you, and I'd like you to follow with me as I read. I'm going to read from the English Standard Version. That's what I'm using of late, but you follow me in your Bible, be all right. And I'm going to read a passage beginning in verse 22, and so maybe you can just follow me silently as I read out loud. Matthew chapter 14 and verse 22, praise the Lord. It says, immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Praise the Lord. I want to share something to you that's on my heart, and I believe it'll help you. This story is an amazing miracle. But miracles don't just happen without rhyme or reason. There's a reason why supernatural things happen in our life. And it's not because God is running a heavenly lottery and you just got lucky today. Are you listening to me? There are clues in this story that unravel the mystery of miracles. And if we will learn the lessons in this passage of Scripture, we too can become water walkers. Are you out there today?
Amen.
Let me just take a moment. Notice in verse 22, it says, he immediately made the disciples get into the boat, go before him to the other side, and he dismissed the crowds. I thought it's interesting, you know, that he dismissed them. And don't worry, I'm not dismissing you. But notice this, that he had been teaching these people for 3 days and healing them. And then he fed them with a little boy's lunch. They didn't want to go anywhere. They were happy to stay there. They didn't say, you know, it's been a long time, and after all, you know, it is time for lunch. No, they wanted to stay. He dismissed them. Some people think that if you're real spiritual, you know, if a church is really spiritual, we should just pray round the clock, nonstop. If you're a Christian, you should just pray, you know, of course, we should pray without interruption or without intermission. But, you know, do you pray while you're chewing your food, or do you pray while you're asleep? I don't think you do. And so some people think we should just have church round the clock, but evidently that's not true.
Amen.
He dismissed these people. Are you listening to me? Amen. Hallelujah. You see, when the pillar of fire moves on, it's time to pack your bags, pull up your tent pegs, because you're heading out. And some people get blessed and they want to camp there and build a monument. And that's why they're not going anywhere. He dismissed them because many Christians are trying to relive the past. You'll never do that. They're looking over their shoulder, fondly remembering the glory years. Oh, I remember when I was younger. I remember back in 1984. I remember back in 1972. I remember, oh, the glory, the power, the miracles. And so they have convinced themselves their best years are behind them. Are listening to me? And so in every church meeting, they're trying to reduplicate the wonders of yesteryear. Yesterday's gone.
Amen.
Get over it. It's never coming back.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Thank God for what He did yesterday. But this is the day the Lord has made. He's got something good for us today. His mercies are new every morning. That means we need some new mercies today.
Amen.
Are you making momentum in the Lord, or are you coasting on yesterday's momentum? Hallelujah. Amen. Listen to something. Rick Warren, he has a church in California. I thought it was interesting something he said. The secret to a vibrant, growing church lies in the surfing skills of its members. What he means is their ability to, quote, catch the waves of what God is doing. He said, if you want your church to explode with growth, you have to stop praying, "Lord, bless what I'm doing."
Yeah.
and instead start praying, Lord, help me to do what you're blessing. Are you listening to me? See, some churches catch a wave of glory and then they ride that wave to the shore and they've been beached there ever since. That's how denominations are started. I said, that's how every denomination in the world was born in a blaze of glory. And most of them suffocated in the smoke. They're dying in the ashes. Why? Because they fondly remember yesterday. Amen. See, sometimes it's not the bad things that are in our past that are holding us back. It's the good things. Get over it. Amen. Let go. Move forward. You can't move on to the next thing God has for you if you won't let go of the past. You'll never start the next chapter in your life until you turn the page. He dismissed them. Why? Because there's something else God wants to do now.
Amen.
And after he dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when evening came, he was there alone. You know, it's interesting. He stole away from the crowd to be by himself. We need fellowship with others, don't misunderstand me, but we also need solitude. Some people, you know, get out of balance one way or the other. Some people, you know, are never with anybody. They're always like loners. Even the Lone Ranger had Tonto, but I mean, they're just always alone. But then other people, they go the other extreme. They always have to be like in the crowd. They always have to just mix. They always need, you know, some kind of distraction going on. I mean, they got three TVs on at the same time in their house, even one in the bathroom for crying out loud. And, you know, and they're always just with people. But there's sometimes you just need to get alone with God. There's some things God doesn't speak to you in a crowd. Are listening to me? That sometimes you just need to shut the door. You know, Jesus said, go into your closet when you shut the door. Well, I'm not suggesting you find the smallest, you know, closet in your house, but you need to shut the door on distractions. Are listening to me? If Jesus needed to be alone, sometimes you need to be alone too. And he prayed there. You know, amazing things happen when Jesus prayed. If you go through the Gospels, you'll see that he had a vibrant, rich prayer life. Now, if Jesus, the divine Son of God, needed to pray, where does that leave you and me? Amen? And in his life, if you study the Bible, you'll see that prayer was always a precursor to the miraculous. In other words, before he walked on water, he prayed. Before there was a supernatural demonstration in public, there was private prayer. Public victories were won in solitude with the Father. You see, the problem is a lot of people, you know, they'll go to a special meeting, and okay, that's fine, but they won't have a meeting with the Lord. Paul Youngie Cho pastors the largest church in the world. He has 1 million members. That's just a little bit more than what we have here this morning. And he spends hours in prayer. So he got a phone call, you know, to the church, and it was the president of South Korea wants to talk to him. His secretary said he's in a meeting. And the man said, excuse me, tell him this is the president of South Korea. She said, I'm sorry, but right now he's speaking with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You'll have to wait. Hallelujah. Are you out there today? Amen. Praise the Lord. And prayer not only changes the circumstances, it prepares us for the challenges ahead. Now see, it's interesting. If you go to Mark chapter 9, you don't have to turn there right now, but if you look at it, you'll see that he went up on a mountaintop to pray. And he only took like, you know, three compadres with him. You know, Peter, James, and John. You know, Mo, Larry, and Curly. The only three went up there with him. And when he prayed, the Bible says he was transfigured. I mean, you know, even his appearance was glowing, brighter than the sun. Even his clothing became radiant, glistening. Hallelujah. And then there was a voice from heaven that said, this is my son, hear him. And they saw Moses and they saw Elijah. In other words, when Jesus had a prayer meeting, nobody went to sleep. Except in the garden. I mean, when Jesus prayed, you know, I mean, supernatural things happening. I mean, the Spirit of God's moving, right?
Yeah.
He wasn't sitting there snoring. And Lord, remember Aunt Betsy, she's not feeling well today. No, there was glory. He was changed. in prayer. Hallelujah. But this is the point. He came down from the mountain. And when he walked in the valley, there was a father there whose son was demon-possessed.
Yeah.
See, some people want to live on the mountain. They never go down the valley. Some people want to, you know, they always want to be alone. And they just want to be isolated. And they think, no, you know, if you're really spiritual, you're always by yourself. The devil told you that.
That's true.
The devil told you that. You need to be on the mountain with the Lord, but you also need to come down in the valley with the people, because you need to take the blessing. You need to take the glory that you received in God's presence, and then you need to be not only a contender for the glory, you need to be a container of the glory and then a carrier of the glory so that other people can be blessed. He came down. And there's a boy, demon-possessed. He cast out the demon spirit. And then the disciples said, why couldn't we do it? And in Mark chapter 9:29, he says this. Mark 9:29, he said, this kind, meaning this kind of demon. That means there's more than one kind, doesn't it? This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. Okay, here's the problem, though. He didn't pray for the boy. He didn't pray with the father, the boy's father. He didn't pray anything. He cast that spirit out. He said, come out of him! See, he did his praying before time when he's on the mountain. His prayers prepared him for the challenges ahead. Most of our praying is backwards, but Jesus always prayed forwards. What I mean by that is this. Most of us, when there's a problem, we say, oh, God, fix the problem. I'm in trouble. Help me, God. And that's fine. Don't misunderstand me. But Jesus preempted the devil's moves. He saw ahead of time the storm was coming, and so he prayed in advance before he got there. So when he stepped into it, he was already ready. See? That's why, you know, they're having dinner together. They're celebrating, actually, Passover together. And he turns and says, Simon, Simon, Satan has desired you that he may sift you like wheat. That would make you shredded wheat. And I have prayed for you. I have prayed for you that your faith would not fail. See, notice, Peter's like, well, there ain't no problem. I'm fine. I don't know what you're talking about. In fact, he's embarrassed. Why are you talking about me? But see, Jesus, before there was a problem, he says, I've already prayed for you.
Yeah.
He did his praying ahead of time, not just backwards. You see what I'm saying?
Right, right.
So I live in Northeast India, and we have a church, and we have a Bible school, and we rely upon guest speakers. Maybe you all, Pastor Stover, maybe one day you'll send your pastor to come and minister for us. I hope so. Praise the Lord. And so the nice thing about living in Nagaland is there's nothing to do. there's no place to go. There's no kind of entertainment. There's just basically, I mean, here you are in Vegas crying out loud. Every kind of restaurant you can think of is here. Whew. You don't ever have to go to the grocery store. And you got everything under the sun is right here, you know. And I'll try to imagine Nagaland, India. That's the opposite. They have nothing to do. You know, nothing. Preach, pray, prophesy, eat your dinner, and go to bed. That's it. You know, there ain't nothing to do. So I have these guests coming over. And so, you know, we would eat lunch together, and we would just talk, just the two of us, talk for like maybe 2.5 hours every day. Which is kind of interesting, because a lot of pastors have never had just 2.5 hours to talk to anybody. That's really amazing. To sit in one chair for 2.5 hours, that's like a miracle, you know? And I'm talking. There was this pastor from North Carolina. And he told me something interesting. He said his mother is a wonderful, very spiritual woman of prayer. And he said as she's praying, the Lord shows her things to pray about. So she prays about them before they happen. See, that's what I'm talking about. That's like Jesus. So he described a situation where he said this, that he was in his car and he was driving. It was a winter time and the roads were icy. This is in North Carolina. The roads were icy and he had an accident. His car almost slid off a mountain, like a hill, you know, with him in it. But he managed to get out the last minute. I think the car was lost, but he was saved. You know, I think he broke his leg, but otherwise, you know, he made it. So it was a real cliffhanger, you know. So he goes home and he calls his mother and says, "Mom, I nearly died today." And she says, "Yeah, I know."
Yeah.
And his mother told him exactly where it was, you know, what had happened. She said, "I saw the whole thing already. I saw that 2 weeks ago. I already prayed about that." And then he gave me other examples. And by the way, he told me something very interesting, which I can't go into great detail right now. He said the Lord also showed him that within the next 2 years, there will be a huge political turmoil in America. It'll be a constitutional crisis, something that has unprecedented, never happened before in this nation's history. He says, and the Lord told her, "You need to start praying right now."
Yeah.
So you can just think about that. Praise the Lord. I asked him for more details. He said, "No, I'm not going to tell you because she told me not to tell you." Hallelujah. Amen. So he prayed before he walked. That's what I'm trying to say, right? See, we all want to walk on water, but nobody wants to spend the time in prayer. And then notice the scripture. James, are you still here today?
Amen.
Every now and then take a breath. It's good for your brain, right? James chapter 4, verse 2 and 3. Listen to this, James chapter 4, verse 2 and 3. It says, "You do not have because you do not ask." All right, we know that. We need to ask. But then it says, "You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly." Other translations say you ask with wrong motives. So that means motive matters. Motivation is the reason why, the real reason. You know, underneath the spiritual or feigned spiritual veneer, what's the real reason you're here today? Because it's Sunday. What's the real reason, you know, that you read the Bible? Because I'm supposed to. You know, what's the real reason that you tithe? Well, everyone will look at me if I don't. You know, what's the real reason? What's the real reason? And see, motive matters to God. That means, James says, you could pray a thoroughly biblical scriptural prayer, quote the Bible verses even in Greek and Hebrew, but if your motive is wrong, God says, I ain't answering that prayer. Thank you for your enthusiasm. It's kind of quiet in this Presbyterian church. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. So, motive. Why? I remember years ago, I was a pastor of church, and so I was studying the topic of gifts of the Spirit. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 12. It talks about all the gifts of the Spirit, you know? 9 gifts of the Spirit, manifestations of the Spirit. So I'm studying, and I'm teaching on Wednesday night, right? And that's a good topic to study. We should study that. So, and it tells us to earnestly desire these things, be zealous, covet these things, covet the best gift, this type of thing, you know? So, you know, while I'm lying on the bed, I like to lie down on the bed with all my books and stuff and study. While I'm studying, I prayed and I said, "Lord, I want these things manifested in my life. I want these gifts of the Spirit in my ministry." And the Holy Spirit spoke to me one word. Why? Man, that stopped the music. I sure didn't see that coming. I said, just one word. Why? And I mean, I was frozen. I was like, I don't have an answer. And then I don't know. I never thought about it. And then inside me, not a voice, but like the Lord was witnessing to my heart. And he said, "What's the real reason that you want these things?" And I said, and he said, is it just so you can be successful? Is that the reason? Is it so that you can be well-liked and appreciated by others? Is that the reason? Is it so that you can make more money? Is that the reason? And I'm like, humma, 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 humma. I'm thinking, all right, just forget it. Just forget the whole thing. I don't want them. You know, sorry I asked. But, and so I had to stop and think about it. Because sometimes, you know, we lie to ourselves. You know, sometimes you wouldn't lie to anybody except yourself. Right? And that's something. Well, what is the reason? Why am I doing this? You know, even you know, I'm a pastor, right? And I appreciate pastors. Pastors are the unsung heroes in the body of Christ, you know. And so, you know, I'm praying. You know, I thought, well, I pray, Lord, I want this church to be bigger. I had to stop and think about, well, why? What's the real reason why? Is it so that others will appreciate me? Is it so I, you know, when I walk down the town, say, "There's Brother John." You know, is that the reason? That can't be the motivation. Motive matters. I want my ministry to grow. Why? So that I can get a front row seat at camp meeting. That's why. You know what I mean? What's the real reason? God knows. See, And if it matters to God, that means He knows. Now, you can lie to God, but you never can deceive God. I mean, He knows. He knows exactly what you're thinking. So there's no sense in trying to fake it. There's no sense faking it. He knows exactly what you're thinking. Isn't that right? Amen. Well, Jesus was moved by compassion. See? Over and over again in the Gospels, we read He was moved with compassion. Moved with compassion. He was never, ever motivated by selfish ambition. He did not heal the sick to become famous. In fact, sometimes He healed people and told them, now make sure you tell no one what happened. Man, we would never do that. We would take a picture, post it on Facebook for sure. Write a book. Right? Right? And if you'll notice in the Bible, sometimes people challenged Him to work a miracle, like the devil or Herod, who's just like the devil. And if you notice, Jesus never did that. When people challenged Him, He wouldn't give into it. He didn't work a miracle just so He would be approved by people, just so they would say, well, you is something else. Ooh, you the man. He never did that. Never did that. He refused. There was the motive matters. The motive was to please His Father. The motive was to help people. There was not even the slightest hint of selfishness or self-centeredness in his ministry or in His prayers either. Are you out there today?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. I heard Brother Hagin years ago, Brother Kenneth Hagin years ago said he spent a lot of time in prayer. He had a prayer life, not just a prayer time. And he said, he very rarely prays about his own needs. He said most of the time, he says, I'm praying about other people. Okay, just got real quiet in here. Praise the Lord. Amen. You ought to think about that. Because if we're not careful, especially people that we're like word people, faith people, sometimes we become very selfish. Let's talk about my miracle. Let's talk about my anointing, my ministry. See, Jesus said, lift up your eyes, for the fields are ripe for harvest. But many people we know can't see the harvest because they have an eye problem. That would be spelled capital I. Right? Many people we know, they're not here to this day, but next time you see them, you tell them I said so. Many people we know, all they think about is their three favorite people, me, myself, and I. No, many people are going to be really amazed when scientists discover that the center of the universe is not you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And you know, while I'm on that topic, you know, the self-centered person is the miserable person. Why am I not happy? Why are other people not treating me right? Why am I not appreciated? Well, I got a news flash for you. How other people treat you is none of your business. I said how other people treat you is none of your business. Your business is how you treat them.
Amen.
That's real quiet in here. Hallelujah. I'm telling you that the self-centered life is the empty life. You look at people who, and our culture has taught us that the whole reason we exist is to please ourselves. Wrong. That's incorrect. We live to please the Father. And God loves people. Sure, He's concerned about you, but He's also concerned about the other guy, too. See, some people can see themselves in Christ. The problem is they can't see anybody else in Christ. Are you out there today?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. See, it's like the signboard said at one church, you know, sorrow shared is cut in half. Joy shared is doubled.
Amen.
Right? You know, someone said, well, I have this faith, but I want it to grow. Well, give it away. Share it with someone else, it'll grow.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Amen. Look in the Bible. Look how many times in the New Testament, the epistles, it talks about one another. Love one another.
Right.
You know, fellowship with one another. You know, encouraging one another. One another. This is not something you do by yourself.
Right.
Living alone in your little box, in your own little world. There is a world out there. And I'm not telling you to go halfway around the world to India. I'm going to ask you to go across the street. Thank you for your enthusiasm. That's the name of this message. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Write that on the CD. Okay, praise the Lord. Amen. So Jesus was compelled by love. By love moved him.
Yeah.
See? And so he's praying and he saw them struggling in the storm. And so love compelled him to move, to act. And of course, the quickest way between two points is a straight line. He just walked on the water. I don't think he stood, you know, on the shoreline thinking, all right, this would be so cool. I was thinking about something to do today that would be, they've never seen me. I already fed them with, you know, little boy's lunch, so I got to do something better than that. I got it. This is so cool. I'm going to walk on water. This is so cool. Now, I'm confessing. I can do all things through myself. Okay, I'm confessing. Here I go. Praise the faith that works is dead. Here we go. Not quite ready yet. Come on, need to confess some more. No, that had nothing to do with it. That had nothing to do with the way he thought at all. He saw the need. His heart was moved with love for them.
Amen.
And he went right to them, walking onto the sea to reach them.
Amen.
You know, even in the natural, we've heard stories where a husband was, you know, working on his car in the garage and the thing fell off the jack and the car landed on top of him. And he's under the car screaming, you know, ah! And his little, you know, 110-pound wife came out in the garage and lifted up the car.
Yeah.
He got out. And the stories like that have happened.
Yes.
Hallelujah. You know, in the natural, she had trouble just lifting up her chair, but she lifted up the car. Glory to God. Amen. Why? Well, you know, faith works by love. So that means you can have all the faith in the world. You don't have any love, your faith won't work. It'd be better if you'd have a little bit of faith and a whole lot of love than all the faith in the world and no love. It's like having a Mercedes-Benz parked in front of your house, but there's no gasoline in the tank. It looks nice, but ain't going anywhere. Right? Amen. So now the story gets real interesting. We'll jump down. We got our time slipping away here. And verse 28, Peter answered him, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. Now, I think it's interesting because Peter took the initiative by asking this. He didn't wait for an invitation. In other words, Jesus didn't walk on the water next to the boat and he said to them, hey, guys, anybody want to join me? It's great out here. The water is good. You know, this is so much fun. Who'd like to come out with me? Raise your hand, one at a time. No, he didn't even say anything like that. Peter took the first step. Peter just said, I'd like to do that too. And I'm sure, you know, the rest of the disciples did not ever imagine Peter would say a thing like that. They're in the side of the boat in a storm. Jesus is walking on the water, and Peter says, if that's you, command me to come out there too. And the rest of them went like, are you crazy? Are you serious? But he took initiative. He took the first step by asking. I think sometimes we're just too passive. We're just sitting here. We're just waiting. Think, well, you know, if the Lord wants me to do something, he'll just do it. Or if he wants me to have something, he'll just give it to me. Or he wants me to do great things, it'll just happen. It'll just fall on me like a hailstorm or something like that. But many times, you know, you think you're waiting on God. In reality, he's waiting on you. Smith Wigglesworth said, faith is audacity.
Yeah.
Interesting. Faith is audacity. That means it's daring. It's the willingness to challenge assumptions or conventions, to do something, tackle something difficult or dangerous. It's having the nerve, the intestinal fortitude, we would say the guts, to ask for something so big people around you get embarrassed. When you ask for a miracle so big it makes the devil nervous, now you're really going somewhere.
Amen.
And Jesus didn't get angry. There's no indication in this story that Jesus was irritated and said, ha, you little pipsqueak, this is something only the Messiah can do. Who do you think you are? Come on, this is my show. You can't steal my thunder. No, it didn't seem like he was irritated at all. In fact, I don't know, from my reading of this, it seems like he was pleased. I somehow just kind of imagine him with a little bit of a smile on his face, like, all right, come.
Yeah.
He answered one word, come. One word. Now, Jesus was a man of few words. He's not near as chatty as we are today. He's a man of few words. You read the Bible, you know, he was just walking around. I had salami for lunch. I'm going to buy some new shoes tomorrow. I got a gray hair today. He's not really a chatty person, you know. But each word was chosen carefully. Each word was full of meaning. He meant what he said. He said what he meant. And he expected others to respond and act upon the words he spoke. In other words, think about this. There is a principle of inflation in the currency of your language. If everyone in America had a tree growing in their compound with dollar bills instead of leaves, wouldn't that be a great thing? Right? No. Why not? Because if dollar bills grew on trees, a cup of coffee would cost $100,000.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. See? The currency would be devalued. There's too much of it. Mm-hmm. It's the same way with our words. If you're just blabbering around, blah, 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 even sometimes quoting scripture verses that you don't really believe or mean, then there's not a lot of depth of meaning in your words.
Yeah.
See, you don't need 1,000 bullets sprayed in 100 different directions. You just need one shot that hits the target.
That's
right. See what I'm saying? And so sometimes we just chatty, blah, 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 yeah, just chatting away. Listen, there's a scripture for you. In Ecclesiastes, it says, God is in heaven, you are on earth, so let your words be few.
That's right.
Deal with it. Hallelujah. Amen. That's right. So, you know, one day he's walking down the street, and there was a man named Levi collecting taxes, and he just stopped and said two words. Follow me. That's it. I mean, you know, there's no explanation. There's no like, you mean like now? Or you mean like this is a permanent situation? Are we talking about a career change here? Are we talking about just like you're going to McDonald's? What are you talking about? Follow me, you know, he didn't explain a lot. He just said one word, come. Sometimes we jump out there and say, oh, Lord, I want a miracle. And he just gives us one word, come. And we're like suddenly, you mean like now? You mean me? Alone? It's one word, come. A lot of times, you know, even in our prayers, you know, we're praying for God to move. And he speaks succinctly. You might be saying, God, I don't have any money. I can't pay my bills. And last night they wanted to take my refrigerator away and I'm behind my car payment. Help me, God! And you want angels, you want heaven to open, you want Holy Ghost moving and glory and thunder and lightning, all that stuff, Steven Spielberg. And you hear one word, tithe.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, that's not the word I wanted to hear, God. I'm looking for something a little more dramatic here, God. God, I'm angry all the time. I can't sleep at night. I'm so stressed. My health is failing. Why don't you do something? And you may hear one word, forgive.
Yeah.
And that's not the word I wanted to hear. Can I get another one? Can I buy a vowel? What was it? You know, they had Celebrity Wheel of Fortune. I don't watch that show, but my parents watch it every night. Celebrity Wheel of Fortune. You know, they had Sylvester Stallone there. And he said, okay, can I buy a vowel? They said, yeah. He said, is there a P? So, you know. If you don't understand that joke, someone will explain it to you later. Hallelujah. How did I get up on that? Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, here's the deal. If Jesus does not say come, you'd better stay in the boat. So, Peter didn't just say, hey, he can do it, watch me. No. He said, Lord, I do need permission. I need to hear from you. I need one, but one word is enough. Jesus didn't preach a sermon on water walking like I'm doing today. He didn't give breakdown of Greek, you know, roots and Hebrew stems or anything like that. He just said, come. But one word from him is enough to uphold you.
Yes.
That one word that said come, that's the same voice that said let there be light in the beginning.
Hallelujah.
Right. Hallelujah. Amen. But here's the whole key to the story. Verse 29. So Peter got out of the boat and walked on water and came to Jesus. Here's the deal. Here's the real thought. If you want to walk on water, you have to get out of the boat.
Yeah.
That's just it. If you want to walk on water, you have to get out of the boat. You can't have your cake and eat it too. Listening to me?
Yeah.
It's not enough to admire the Word of God or even to acknowledge our faith in it. That's fine. We must act upon it. Peter, in the boat, could have said 100 times, I believe. He could have said it even with a little Pentecostal quiver in his voice. Ah, I believe, Lord. You know, he could have sung it. I believe. It didn't make no difference. He could have sung a song about water walking. I'm a water walker. Can I get an amen? And the other disciples could have said, uh-huh. But it don't make any difference. You can sing about it all you want to. You're never going to walk on water unless you get out of the boat. Right? Isn't that right? There's a lot of wasted time and energy in our lives because none of those things are a substitute for obedience. Faith operates on the principle of risk and reward. Hallelujah. Now, by nature, I'm a cautious person. I'm not the kind of person just, you know, I don't go bungee jumping for kicks. I don't go skydiving, you know. I'm a very cautious person. You know, even before I buy a pair of shoes, I'll Google it. You know, study like what kind of shoes to buy. I'm a very cautious person. But the deal is this, if we are called to live by faith, we must become risk takers. Faith works on the principle of risk and reward. So there are many people who want to walk on the water, but they don't want to get out of the boat. They want reward without risk. They want outcome without obedience. And it just doesn't work that way.
Right.
Are you here today? Yep. Hallelujah. So, if Jesus is calling you out of the boat, nothing's going to happen until you do that. Sometimes people say, the Lord hasn't spoken to me in 25 years. What's the last thing He said to you? He said to become a member of this church. Have you done that? No, I'm still waiting on the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, when you take that step, then He'll give you the next step.
That's right.
Yeah.
Thank you for your enthusiasm.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. What's the last thing He said to you? Did you do that?
Well, no. I didn't. But I want, you know, an angel to appear to me. You don't need an angel to appear to you. You just need to do what He said.
Amen. Get out of the boat. And you know, the thing is this, like the Chinese say, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step, right? That first step is the hardest. Many people are frozen in fear. They suffer from the paralysis of analysis. They're sitting in the boat thinking about what could be, what should be, what might be, and time is wasting. You're not getting any younger. You need to get out of the boat. You need to take that first step. The first step's the hardest. But you know, one step of obedience could be the beginning of a marvelous adventure in Christ.
Amen.
You never know how much glory, how thrilling it is to walk on water till you try it. With nothing under your feet but the Word of God.
Yeah.
I heard a story about a man, a businessman, in Washington, D.C. I'm actually originally from Virginia, which is not far from D.C. And this man was an insurance agent, insurance business. Though he lived in Washington, D.C., he had no political connections, whatever. And he got saved. He got born again. And as a new Christian, he had a great hunger for the Word of God. That's the way it should be. And there was another Christian that was an older, mature man who was like, you know, discipling him, kind of like mentoring him, had like a little Bible study with him and was helping him to learn the Word of God, and that's very good. And so one day, they met together, and this insurance agent, he said, you know, I read a scripture verse last night that really just thrilled me. What is it? Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 13 and 14, and whatever you ask in my name, that's what I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. And the man said, praise the Lord. That's right, brother. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And he said, does that mean what it says? And the man said, yes, it does. So I can just ask anything in Jesus' name and he'll do it. And the guy goes, certain provisions there in the Greek and Hebrew. And he could see the guy's confused. And he said, yeah, it means what it says. He said, okay, good. I'm going to ask for something. He said, okay. What are you going to ask for? And he said, I'm going to ask for Kenya. The man says, the country? Yeah. What? Yeah, I'm going to ask for Kenya. Why? He says, I don't know. Have you ever been to Kenya? No. Do you know someone from Kenya? No. Have you ever been to Africa? No. Why are you doing this? He said, I don't know. But I just want to do it. And the guy thought, this is crazy. What on earth? I thought he was going to ask, you know, pay the rent or something like that. You know, Kenya's a nation. So he said to the man, well, he didn't want to discourage him. You know, here it's really embarrassing when the young protege has more faith than the mentor. So it's hard to explain that away, isn't it? And so he said this. I'm not suggesting that you do this, but I thought it was interesting. He said, I'll tell you what we'll do. He said, for 1 month, every morning when you wake up, you say, Lord, use me to be a blessing to Kenya. Use me in some way or some way, you know, let Kenya be changed for your glory. And I want you to pray that way every day for 1 month. And he said, I'll tell you what, if nothing happens after 30 days, I'll give you $50. Like a bet. Now, like I said, I'm not suggesting you do that. I don't think that's particularly, you know, okay. Don't write that down in your notebook. Okay? So the guy said, okay, I'll do that. And so for every morning, he prayed for Kenya in the name of Jesus. He said, well, I can have whatever I ask in your name. I'm asking you for Kenya. Well, for 29 days, nothing happened. It looked like he's going to lose the bet. And on the 30th day in D.C., he was invited to a dinner, some kind of a formal dinner, some kind of thing. And at this big round table, he was seated next to a woman from
Kenya.
Exactly, Kenya. And so he's talking to her and asking her all these questions and everything. He's the first person he's ever met from Kenya. And so she was so impressed by his curiosity, she said, well, would you like to visit our work in Kenya? Because she had run an orphanage. And he said, sure. So he flew out to Kenya, and he visited, you know. And when he saw the need in the orphanage, his heart was touched. He went back to America, and he wrote to all the pharmaceutical companies, and he said, listen, you have a lot of excess medicine. You can't even sell it now, and it's still good. Why don't you ship it to these people in Kenya? There are little children there that, you know, could need that medicine. And I guess he's a good letter writer because several of these pharmaceutical companies, they took him up on it. They even paid for the shipping, and they sent it to Kenya, you know. So, you know, the lady was so excited, she said, well, we want you to come back because we've opened up a new wing or something or some new buildings, and we want you to come and be part of the inauguration. So he said, sure. So he went. And so because it was the largest orphanage in Kenya, the president of Kenya also attended the meeting. And after the meeting was over, he took this fellow, this insurance agent from D.C., in his vehicle and drove him around. He just kind of gave him a little personal tour. And they passed by a penitentiary, and this insurance agent saw some men milling about behind the barbed wire and the fence. And he asked, who are these people? And the president said, they're political prisoners. And he said, oh, that's wrong. You should let them go. That's all. And so then when it's over, he flew back to America. And when he got back to America, he got a phone call from the State Department. And they said, have you been in Kenya? And he said, yeah. And he says, have you been talking to the president of Kenya? He said, yeah. And he said, why? He says, well, because we have been dealing with him for a long time to release some political prisoners, but he kept refusing. But yesterday, he released all the political prisoners. And we asked him, why did you do it? And he told us, because you told him to do it. And then, that's not all, then later on, the president of Kenya contacted him and said, we've just had an election, and I'm going to have a new cabinet installed. I want you to fly out here. We're going to fly you out here. We want you to pray over each minister in our cabinet. And this is from a man who has no political connections at all. If you want to walk on water, you have to get out of the boat. It's the first step that's the hardest. Are you out there today? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I moved to Nagaland in 1994. We live in a small city. It's kind of dirty and dusty and all of that. It's your typical Indian city, to be honest with you. And we got an apartment. And our apartment was small, cramped, hot, no privacy whatsoever. You're in the hallway, open the door, boom, there you are in the main room. You know, no little hallway or something like that. And one time I was just sitting, it's hot. At that time, we didn't have any air conditioning or anything. And it's like, you know, 110 degrees in the shade. Of course, you all know about that, don't you? And preaching to the choir here. And it was real stinking hot. But it's real humid there. It's not dry like it is, real humid. And so I'm sitting on this little stool underneath a ceiling fan like you have there. And I took my shirt off. You know, pastors sometimes do that. I don't shower in my suit either. And I don't know if you know that. But so I'm sitting there. I took my shirt off. I'm just wearing some little shorts, no shoes, and just sweating pouring down. And suddenly the front door opens to my apartment. It's one of my church members. And there's like three little, you know, nicely dressed, you know, prim and proper ladies with him. And he says, "Sisters, this is our pastor." And I'm there like a caveman, ooga booga. And I was so embarrassed. And then it's noisy because it was right on the highway. So all the traffic's going right by our apartment. They build the thing like just a few feet from the highway. And so, you know, like I'm on the phone talking to my mother in America, and they have lots of trucks. It's a main route, and lots of trucks, big trucks, and they would blow their horns as they went down that road. And in India, their horns have these little irritating little tunes and stuff like that. You know, it's not just a beep beep. Sometimes they've got little musical tunes. So I'm there talking to my mother, and she's telling me something important about my dad or something. And right in the middle of the conversation, I said, "Say that again, Mom." Da 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 da. I said, "Mom." You know, and it's just, you know, it's the truck going by, and then there's clouds of dust that would come up from the traffic. It's coming in there. It's not the glory. It's the dirt, and it's just terrible. No privacy, and it's hot, and you know, and I'd had it. We'd lived there for like a year or so, and I'd had it. And we tried to rent a house, and they gave it to somebody else. We tried to rent another place, and they wouldn't give it to us, and I was fed up. I was fed up. And so I went in the back room, and I shut the door, and I pulled what I call the nuclear option, which means I told God, "I can't take this anymore. We tried to, you know, rent a place, couldn't do it, and I don't have a house except this apartment, and I can't take this anymore. So if you don't do something, I'm leaving now. I'm gonna come back here again." Yeah, I was just fed up. And you know what? It's interesting. God didn't get angry with me. I mean, a bolt of lightning didn't strike me down or nothing. I heard inside me these words. I heard a voice speak to me. I mean, almost turned around, you know, thought someone was in the room. I heard a voice speak to me and say, "I will provide."
Amen.
Well, when I heard that, because that's supernatural, that's like Jesus saying, "Come." You know, I was like, "Oh, praise God." So I came out of the room, "Praise the Lord." He said, "I will provide." And for a day or two, I kind of was still in the euphoria of that experience. And then it suddenly dawned on me that my domicile residence has not changed. And nothing has changed. I mean, you know, I'm waiting for money to come from the sky or something. Nothing happened. And I went on for like several months. And then, you know, I was actually talking to my own pastor, and something he said just kind of snapped in me. Maybe when he says, "I will provide," he doesn't mean that you just sit back and just relax and just enjoy the ride. Maybe what he means is get out of the boat. Start to build your house. And I thought, that's what he means. See, he just says, "Come." So I told my wife, "We're going to build a house." She said, "Well, that's fine, but there's one small detail." I said, "What's that?" She said, "We don't have any money." I said, "Yeah, I know that." I said, "We actually had a little plot of land, 100 feet by 100 feet, that we did buy earlier. And so we had that. So I asked my wife, well, if we were going to build a house, what would we do? She said, well, number one, we need to have a plan. All right? So we contacted someone who we had a church member who was an architect. So he drew the plans for us of the house, and he didn't even charge us. Not then, later on we paid him something, but he didn't even charge us. So we had the plans. I said, what's next? She said, so you got to take the next step. She said, well, in India, you always build a wall around your property. You always, like in Las Vegas, almost everybody has a wall around theirs. But in India, the first thing you do is build a wall because, you know, if you don't have a wall, you wake up one morning and you look out the window and say, that's funny. Doesn't it look like our neighbor's house is closer to our house than it was yesterday? Yeah, that's real funny. The next day you wake up, I thought it was way over there. It's right over there. Next day you wake up, you're living in a duplex. Next day you wake up, you're outside and he's in your house. Right? They encroach on your land. It's still your land. So you have to. She said, we build a wall. Well, we had a little bit of money, so it actually doesn't cost that much to dig a hole. I mean, maybe in Las Vegas it probably cost more. But in India, it didn't cost that much to dig a hole, so we dug the hole, started to build. We actually, you know, somehow the money came, we build the wall. I said, praise the Lord. What's next? She said, you build a foundation. So again, dig some holes, we did the foundation, so we did that thing, you know. And we started putting the columns up, and we had it like kind of like had some kind of a little structure coming up, and then, you know what that is? That's the opposite of wellspring. That's dry gulch. No more money. Just that's it. No more money, nothing. And I stood there, you know, one morning, and here's a few columns, and this slab is there, and a wall. That's it. And I said, Lord, you said, I will provide. So I'm holding him to it. Hold his feet to the fire, sort of. And the Lord spoke to me this time, not like a voice I heard, but in my heart, a whispering voice of the Holy Spirit said to me, "Go to America." So I thought, okay. So I went to America, and after I'd been settled in a little bit, you know, I went to go have lunch with my pastor in America. Though I'm a pastor, I have a pastor. And so I'm driving over to their house, over to their church rather, and I'm thinking in my mind, how much money do we need to finish this house? And I calculated it, and it was X amount of dollars. You know, I don't want to tell you, but it's X amount of dollars. And, you know, and I knew exactly how much it was. Well, I'll tell you, it was like $36,000. $36,000, what I needed. Things are cheaper in India. That's what I needed. But when you don't have any money, it doesn't matter. You know, and so in my mind, I said, I need $36,000. And so I got to the church, and the pastor met me, and, you know, chit-chat, da-da, how you doing? We appreciate you, and kind of the normal type of pleasantries and stuff like that. And then his wife came in the office. She said, how you doing? And the first thing she said to me is, what about your house? That's the first thing she said, what about your house? And I said, well, you know, we're building it, but we had to stop and, you know, need some more money. And she said, how much money do you need to finish your house? And I was like, well, you know, I mean, a little embarrassed, you know, to say, it's a lot. And she said, how much? And I'm like, you know, it's a lot of money. You don't want to say how much. It's like, you know, it's like if you give somebody a Christmas gift, how much did you pay for this? You know, you don't want to tell the person, sort of embarrassed. You know what their reaction might be, you know. So I said, it's just a lot. And I'm not lying to you. She looked right at me. She said, do you need $36,000? Wow. Yeah. There's no way on earth she could have known that. I was figured it out in my head on the way over there. And no way on earth she could have known that. And I looked at her and I said, that's exactly how much I need. And she said, you'll get it. And so again, I thought, oh, praise the Lord, my heart is just beaming. So I thought she's going to go into her desk drawer and write a check. doesn't that seem like the logical conclusion from that statement? Well, go get it, Pastor. I'm waiting. But it didn't happen that way. But from several different sources, I got the money and we built that house. And the day we moved in, I stood on the threshold of that front door, and I remembered that little room in the apartment, and I said, God, you said, I will provide, and you did it. But see, you have to get out of the boat if you want to walk on water. Are you listening to me? What's your boat? It's the familiar place. It's the place that, relatively speaking, seems a whole lot safer than out there. But you know, actually, the safest place in the world is not in the boat. It's in the will of God. I moved to India in 1994. I've been there 20 years. And I don't have time to go into all the details, but India is a very volatile place, especially where I live. They have like armed militants roaming around and kidnapping and killing people. But I remember turning on the television set in India, and it was like a year or so later, and there was the news bulletin about the Oklahoma City building that had been bombed. And suddenly it just struck me through and through, the safest place in the world is not America. It's the perfect will of God for your life.
Amen.
The most prosperous place in the world is not Vegas or LA or DC. It's in the perfect will of God for your life. So actually, it may seem nice and cozy in the boat, but that's not the most secure place. Where is your boat? I'll tell you one thing, it's the crowded place because it's where 99% of all Christians live. You'll never be alone in the boat, but it's kind of lonely out there on the water by yourself. It's real lonely. And you know, when you're in the boat, you don't have to be afraid of people criticizing you. Because when you walk on water, people will definitely criticize you. They will talk about you. You know, and if you go down like Peter did, they'll say, aha, aha, I knew it, I knew it, I knew it. But I'd rather get out of the boat, even if I fail, and to spend the rest of my life wondering what would have and could have been if only I had the courage to try. Are you listening to me? Where is the boat? It's the place of unfulfilled dreams. It's the place of small expectations. It's the place where we become Sunday morning Christians who more or less turn our worship into recreation. It's also the boring place, because something in your heart is telling you there's more to life than this. There's a higher plan for my life. And it's not just about you. It's not just about you. God doesn't call you out of the boat just so you can have an adventure, have a thrilling time. There's more than that. There's other people involved. If I hadn't left my home in America and gone to India, that would have affected a lot of other people, people I didn't even know about, people I, at the time I couldn't have imagined. When you obey God and step out of your boat, you'll find out that that affects a lot of other people. Not only will it affect them, but your testimony will inspire other water walkers to get out of their boat as well. You know, it's interesting. Sometimes, I guess I need to wrap this up. Can you give me a couple of more minutes? I don't know what time you go home. You're having a potluck supper right now. If I see you eating, I'll know I've gone too long. May I just say one more thing to you then? Sometimes it seems Jesus picks the wrong time to say come. This story, the Bible says, it occurred during the fourth watch of the night. That would be between 3 and 6 a.m. in the morning. And remember, the boat, it says, was a long way away from land. In the New Testament, it's originally written in Greek. The Greek language literally says many stadia, which is a measurement. And one stadion is about 607 feet. Okay, so that means if this boat was 8 or 9 stadia from the shore, it would be 1 mile offshore. So it's not just 10 feet away from the dock, right? And the Sea of Galilee is 141 feet deep at its center, with an average depth of 84 feet. Oh, and besides that, there is still this terrible storm raging. The storm didn't stop just because Jesus showed up. And then he says, come. I mean, Peter could have said, I want to walk on water, but now is not a good time. Lord, it's dark outside. I don't even like to swim in my swim pool at night. I mean, out here in the middle of the Sea of Galilee at night, it kind of freaks me out, God. Could we do this in the morning? And by the way, I can't even see the shoreline. It's like 84 feet deep here. I was wondering, could we like pull up a little closer to the shore and maybe if it's, could I try it on ankle deep water? That way if I fail, I won't die. Amen. And if we could just wait till all of this typhoon passes over, I'd feel a whole lot better about this whole proposition. But you see, to God, time means nothing. Because He lives in the realm of eternity. But timing is everything. In the fullness of time, God sent forth His Son. Timing is everything. And sometimes, if we delay too long, we miss the plan of God. The moment passed, it's over now. Are listening to me? If you're waiting for the perfect scenario to get out of the boat, you're going to be waiting a long time. If you live 100 years old, it ain't going to happen. We don't live in a perfect world, and there will never be a perfect time. When He says come, that's the perfect time. When God dealt with me about going to Nagaland, I was working in the business world, and I was married. I had a daughter. Daughter was just born, and I had received a lump sum of cash as part of an inheritance, you know. And so the thought that came to my mind was, now, what I can do is I can take a leave of absence and I can go to India. I can do that. I got the money now. And even people were telling me, you can do that. Why don't you do that? And so it seemed like, you know, it's fair winds, good weather for sailing. Here we go. This is like a perfect water walking scenario. But something in my heart didn't feel right. I can't explain it, but it just didn't. You know how you drive a stick shift car and you got it in the wrong gear and the thing's like bucking? That's how it felt inside. You're in the wrong gear. And I just felt like the Lord said to me, not now. Don't go. And I'm like, all right, well, what am I going to do? And I struggled with it for a long time, and a lot of it was my own apprehensions. But finally, I came to this that helped me. Maybe it'll help you too. I said, all right, if money was no object, if that was not even an issue, what would I do? You know, forget about the money. If that was not a problem, what would you do? And I said, well, I know what I would do. I would start going to churches in America, and I'd start preaching wherever the door was opening. I would start itinerating, just going and preaching. Not to raise money for missions, just to go to preach. And I thought, like, well, that's what I should do then. And it wasn't easy because, you know, there not a lot of opportunities came my way. And mind you, I was 27 or so years old at that time. Now I'm 30. And so, anyhow, no one's laughing. And you know, I did that. But after a while, the money dried up. And so then I got a job working in a call center. And so I'm doing that, but then I'm preaching on weekends, see? But then in the meantime, my daughter, she broke her leg. She broke her femur bone. And they had to actually take her to the OT, not the Old Testament, the operating theater, and they had to put a body cast on her from her hips down to her ankles, two legs, and a bar between them. And then we had to pay for that. And we didn't have any kind of health insurance, something like that. And when they told me the bill, I thought, I don't want to buy the hospital. I just want to get my daughter, you know. And I couldn't believe it. It was thousands of dollars they want me to pay for one day in the hospital. I thought, you know, can't we just go to a hotel and do this? And then we had moved from a condominium that we were renting on a month-to-month basis. The lady came back. We had to move out. So we got it signed a lease, you know. And so we got a year lease. Oh, the hospital, thousands of dollars. Oh, and I forgot to tell you, I lost my job. I went from the call center to a Christian ministry, and one day they called me in and said, sorry, we're having some cutbacks, so we're laying you off, which is a nice way of saying you're fired. And I came home at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. My wife was lying on the couch. When I walked over, she rose up. She said, what are you doing home now? She said, well, they laid me off, so I decided to take the rest of the day off. You know, so I don't have a job. Don't have any money. Money's all gone. And I owe the hospital money. I can't break my lease. And then the Lord said to me, go. I thought, What's the deal? I mean, like, you know, like a couple of years ago, I was ready. We had the money, you know, all the green lights, and you said no. And now we don't have any money. We owe everybody in town, and you say go? Seems like we're not on the same page here, you know. But in my heart, the Lord was telling me, you know, basically, get out of the boat. Now it's time to go. To make a long story short, I can tell by the looks on your face, it's going to be real short. Within 6 months from the time I lost my job, I was on the plane to go to Nagaland. And money came in from some very unusual sources, I should say. Actually, a family member paid the hospital bill. And if you knew that family member, you knew that God just parted the Red Sea. And and the people on the lease, they changed their mind. They said, okay, fine. And then not only that, but money began to come in from different sources. It just came in, and we were there. And I thought, why? Because it's going to have to be supernatural anyways. You can't walk on water even on a clear day. Doesn't matter. You can't walk on water even if it's half a foot deep. Doesn't matter. That has no bearing on it. So it might as well be, you know, impossible, because it's impossible anyhow. Amen. And the greater the test, the greater the testimony. Amen. Are you out there today?
Yes.
I said, are you out there today?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, it's time for me to quit. But let me just finish this way. Again, if you want to walk on water, you have to get out of the boat.
Yep.
It's scary in the natural, in your flesh. You're apprehensive because you're afraid I'll fail. But I want to say something to you. When I was in high school, these words were on the wall of our gymnasium. And I read them to you. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who was actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. I'd rather get out of the boat, even if I fail, and to spend the rest of my life wondering what could have been, what would have been, if only I had obeyed.
Yeah.
I want to pray for you. Would you stand with me to your feet?
Yes. Yes.
Is there something maybe the Lord's been dealing with you about? Maybe it has something to do with your ministry, or maybe it has something to do with starting a new business or changing the direction of your career. I don't know, but maybe there's a sense of dissatisfaction in your heart and you feel crestfallen, even discouraged. You can become very depressed. Inactivity leads to despondency. Sometimes one of the best things that will help us for our mental health is to just get out and go. Do it. Take a step. God will help you. Some people are praying, oh Lord, I need direction, but you can't steer a parked car. You got to get moving. The real deal is this, not that God is hard of hearing or he's forgotten your cell number. The real deal is this, that you're afraid. You're afraid to try. You're afraid to take that first step. You're afraid of failing. What you don't realize is if you don't take that step, If you get out of that boat, there is a possibility because of your own weakness you could fail, but if you don't take that step, it's guaranteed you'll fail. Get out of the boat. Obey him. Just do what he says to do. Is there a vision in your heart like the man for Kenya? Is there a passion in your heart to reach out to people or to do something, but you don't know how? if you will just take the small step. When you walk through that door, it may be a very small door, like sitting next to a woman in a restaurant, but you have no idea where that journey will take you. But it's up to you, actually. We've prayed and we've pleaded, but the ball's in your court now. And I really feel for many of us, God's saying, I'm actually waiting on you. And I'm not the one that's limiting you. That's you. That's you. Everybody wants fruit, but you have to go out on a limb to pick the fruit. You need the audacity to try. You need the audacity to try. Now, if God didn't say get out of the boat, then stay in the boat, okay? Don't just do something because you heard a sermon and you got tingles up and down your backbone. But you know in your heart what God's asking you to do, and it seems hard. I stand here as a man who went to the other side of the world with nothing but my wife, my daughter, two suitcases, and a fistful of dreams. And I stand here to tell you that He's faithful.
Amen.
He's faithful. He will not fail you. So I'm going to pray for you. Father, I pray for the church. I pray for these precious people. I pray that you'll take this message and help them to become water walkers. I pray that you'll help them to brave the elements, to ignore the criticism, to ignore the possible shame of failure, to look squarely into the eyes of the Master, to hear His voice, but to respond in obedience. I pray, Father God, that you'll help them to take the first step, to walk through the door, to take the opportunity, to make the most of every day because the days are evil. I pray, Father God, for there are people here who have a stirring in their heart to do great things for God, but they also seem so limited, and they're wondering, but how? How is this going to happen? Don't let your dreams die with you, my friend. Your God is big enough, and your dream is not too big for Him. Oh, my friend, don't spend the rest of your life wondering what could have, what would have been. Don't go down into the grave with regret. Get into the arena of life. Fight valiantly. God's with you. And I'm going to tell you something. You're not alone on the water. That's where you'll come face to face with the man from Galilee. That's where you'll find His touch. And even when you fail, and I'm sorry to say that we often do fail, Peter cried out, Lord, save me. And a hand reached down and pulled him up. They walked back together and tied the boat. Say what you like about Peter. He may have messed up, he may have failed, but he did one thing you haven't done. He walked on water. I pray, Father, for all of us, that you'll help us to have the courage. I pray, Father God, that you'll help us. May the direction of the Holy Spirit be clear in our hearts, Father God. I pray, Father God, that you'll bless them and strengthen them. In the name of Jesus, I pray.